Hello again, everyone. It's good to have you with us for this event. It figures to be an exceptional one, one that doesn't need any buildup.
Are you ready?
Don't ever give up.
Athletes, huddle up. It's time to begin. Get focused. Let's go.
It's only been a little bit. This is Overtime with Coach Blue and Athletic Director Marissa.
Oh, yeah. I forgot we renamed it.
Yeah. Well, one-on-one Welcome. With two people kind of sounded a little funny. They're like, what's going on, you two? Our weekly call-in question Q&A show for you guys, the listeners and the viewers today. This will be turned around into a podcast that will be released later this week. And it's where we get to answer some questions that you guys might have. We're able to field a little bit of the information that we're gathering and some of the stuff that we're doing on Team Addict Athlete as it pertains to mental health and addiction recovery. A lot of stuff that Marissa and I both do in our lives beyond Addict Athlete revolve around therapeutic investments with the community, with private practice therapy and recreational therapy with Marissa. So we've got a lot of a deep pull between the two of us, I think, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah. And so, today, listeners, we're going to jump into some awesome content, some stuff that I've noticed I want to share with you just to see if you guys have felt that same pulse that we're feeling in the community and in the world at large. But before we do that, I want to thank all of you for, jumping in and participating in our No One Left Behind Team Half Marathon. It was a great success.
Awesome.
It happened this last weekend.
Yeah, so good.
Yeah.
The weather was perfect, and yeah, it was beautiful.
Yeah, and we had a good strong push right towards the end to get quite a few people registered. And, I think we're going to do it again next year. So it's going to be a great opportunity to come out and, run a half marathon with a couple of your friends and just kind of get that mindset of like, no one finishes alone. You start together, you finish together.
Yeah.
And there's some cool things in between. So
absolutely.
Yeah.
And it's every June. So if you didn't do it this year and if you did, start planning now. We'd
love
to have you next year.
Good feedback. But now our attentions turn to kind of the more humble event that Addict Athlete provides, and that is the 2023 Proxy Run is to be held this September in Spanish Fork, Utah. This is a lot more emotionally based, I would say, than the No One Left Behind, because you run proxy for someone who's currently struggling with mental health or addiction, or someone who's lost their battle to mental health or addiction. And there's a little spot on the bib number by which you, proclamate their name, and you take that out and you run with them as proxy for them. And, this has been a really powerful healing event, to be honest with you. There's always some neat things that happen. We got a few more surprises up our sleeves to kind of help bring that spirit of recovery there and that unity that I think needs to be established, and some of which we're going to talk about today. But you can register for that right now as well. Registration's open on addict2athlete.org. Go underneath our events tab in the races. You'll see it there.
Yep. And it's like $10, $15 if you want to do virtual. We have a virtual option. We can send you the bib number and then an additional $10 if you want a shirt. But
absolutely.
We want to keep the prices down so everyone can participate. This is one that's, 5K is only 3.1 miles. So it's, you can come walk it. You can push a stroller, bring a kid on a scooter. Just come and have fun.
We'd love to have you come participate, though, if you're in the area. And what we've seen is a lot of people, bring family systems together, and they all go run and walk, as proxy for their loved one. So get a team together, gather some friends and family, and come and remember the individual that might be struggling or has lost their battle. It is a healing process, and as we say on Team Addict Athlete, movement equals healing. So jump on. Marissa, before we dive into some of the thick of things, it's been a minute, but we want to thank our Patreon subscribers. I think our Patreon subscribers are the backbone of what we do here on the podcast, whether it be the Overtime, whether it be the main program with his Addict Athlete podcast, and even the Agents of Recovery. You guys help do this podcast a great favor by participating. And I love the Patreon program because we give you something back in return. So would you mind introducing those champions in my eyes?
All right. So our super fans, we want to thank Karen Hardy, Steve Riggs, Tracy Whitby, Jerem Thurston, Tara Butson, Holly Davies, Scott Foster, Brett Frew, Chris Williams, Sensei KP Brown, Patrick Forsyth, Brock Ellerman, and Christy Case.
Thank you.
Rookie levels, Sherry Poulsen, Earl Dyer, Wendell Wood, Brad Waldron, Gary Thurston, Ron and D. Loesch, and Sione and Mary Inuk. Thank you, our rookies. Pro level, Justin Robbins, and champion level, Shad and Freya Robison and Andrew Baird. Thank you so much to our Patreon subscribers. you can become a Patreon at patreon.com/addicttoathlete.
Absolutely. And, you know, I cannot thank you all enough. So, you know, again, hearts out to you. We're going to be recording several more this exclusive Patreon episodes coming up this week. So stay tuned for that. And again, thanks so much for all that you do. Jump on there, Addict to Athlete Patreon program. So we'll leave some links in some of the descriptions here in the video in the podcast. Yep. Marissa, some interesting thing happening in the world. And, you know, I'm going to admit it here and right now that I tend to watch a little TikTok and a little bit of, you know, reels and things like that, because you know, the attention span for someone with ADHD like myself is very short, and that kind of provides that dopamine dump. But yesterday, like, it was kind of a crazy thing. There's a very scary situation happening, and you guys are all probably aware by now of the missing submarine with a bunch of people in there going down to see the wreck of the Titanic. And as devastating as that is, as heartbreaking as that is, and the more time you spend thinking about it, the deeper into, like, this, like, fear of depression you can get into, this claustrophobic feeling, because I'm like, I got to stop watching this.
Yeah.
I've noticed this very strange thing happen. At first, when the news started to break, where there was this tragic event, we see a lot of people that voice concern. And once they found out that there were millionaires on board, I saw so many, like, people begin to shift their perspective and get to this negative mindset. And it was a really weird thing, because, like, it went from, we hope we find them, you know, the prayers are being said in their behalf, to how stupid are these people? They're millionaires, think they can do anything. And it was this weird shift in, like, empathy.
Yeah.
And I started to peel back the layers a little bit. I've noticed this quite a bit, that I think one thing that we're missing, like, very heavily in the country, in the world right now, is this sense of empathy, the sense of tragedy that could be labeled as maybe a time to unite and to, you know, kind of, like, embrace what we're seeing, what I'm seeing. And maybe I'm just noticing the negative, I don't know. But what I've noticed is that there is an abundance of, like, lack of empathy in people that want to pick fault or make jokes or make light of. And it got me thinking about the social temperament that the world's kind of leaning to. And we see it in a lot of different areas. It's not just situations like this. We see it with people, you know, in poverty. We see it in race, and we see it in addictions and recovery and that kind of stuff. We see this social temperament kind of beginning to slip.
Yeah.
And I was kind of doing a little bit of a dive, because I'm like, well, what if this is a problem that I'm seeing, am I contributing to it, or am I hoping to eliminate it by trying to kick out some positive? The problem is that there's a lot more negative than there is positive sometimes. And sometimes it can feel like you're being drowned by, like, yeah, you know, all that negative stuff.
I think sometimes that's where it comes from, is everyone else is doing it, so it becomes, like, the new norm, right?
Yeah. And social temperament comes from the personality traits that we possess, and our thoughts and our behaviors and our patterns. They kind of start to manifest over the years. And this is something that truly is developed in young adolescent life, right?
Yeah.
And in fact, if you follow, like, Gary Vee, he talks about this a lot, that, like, the number one trait that we all need to probably start really investing in, specifically with some of these newcomers, these up and coming kids in school and the workforce, is, do you remember what he said?
Empathy. Self-awareness.
Yep. Emotional intelligence, and being able to understand and be able to feel. But I'm wondering why the society is kind of kicking that out into a situation by which we're ignoring that. You know what I'm saying? Like, where we're saying, well, this was sad, but now we can point fingers at how stupid it is, or how dumb that is, or, you know what I'm saying? Like,
well, and I think with technology the way it is and all the information that we have in the world today, it's easy to get caught up in information, data, rather than, empathy is emotions, and it's really hard to measure, and it's hard to understand, and it's something that's a little subjective, and, you know, and so it's easier to teach information and have people gather, you know, data than it is to, like, how do you teach empathy and getting people to understand and be able to respond to other people's emotions and to, you know, just have understanding of where they're at, where they're coming from.
Yeah. And so when you look at some of the primary personality traits, the things that kind of make us who we are, and then level that to the degree of how socially temperamental can we become, or kind of like navigate through, you know, some of the situations that we are, you know, unfortunately kind of thrust into.
Yeah.
You look at some of the first ones as like the agreeableness of a person versus the antagonism of a person. So, you know, these two paradigms are, if you're an agreeable person, then that means you're going to go with the flow. You're going to be the guy who follows the law. You're going to do the kind of things that mm-hmm. make people, you know, you know, maybe flow to that the beat of the drum, so to speak, right?
Yeah.
So if you're an agreeable person, it means you're not going to be one of those individuals that causes waves.
Sometimes the people pleaser.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. And there's nothing wrong with that. And in fact, I find that that's kind of when the world kind of turns its best, because it refers to people that are more affectionate and maybe a little bit more kind and a little bit more altruistic, right?
Yeah, understanding.
Versus the people that antagonize. And those are the people that kind of like stir the pot a little bit. And I see this a lot on social media where...
waves, right?
Yeah, where there's always this antagonism that kind of happens, where if someone's, you know, kind of perching themselves up to a spot where they're looking good or doing something that's worthwhile, that there's always that person, that naysayer, that has to throw their wrench into it.
Yeah.
And that's what I've been seeing a lot of, this antagonism for no purpose or no reason. What benefits do you think being an antagonist would truly be in a person's world? Like, why would... because there are benefits, yeah, but I'm curious what you think.
Attention, yeah. Number one. I think it also comes down to control. I mean, how awesome is it to have that control of the situation that you can make people get upset and explode and react to something you did?
Yeah.
Right?
And absolutely.
So that a lot of people in the world don't feel like they have control. And if you can antagonize, all of a sudden you take control of the situation or somebody else's emotions, and that's a powerful thing.
Yeah. Yeah. So I saw this today too on again, social media, TikTok. And, you know, I'm going to see if I can have producer Max over there push up the level for the phone, like the phone. I think it's like right there on the mixing board. You're going to see it's like, yeah. And I think I'm still connected to it. Let me check real quick. But yeah. I saw this today and it was, not yet. Yeah. It hasn't gone through yet, but it should. Let me just push play here in a second. That's where I find it. But a premise of this was the antagonism and why we need to have some antagonists in this mindset. Mm-hmm. Max, I think it's okay, brother. It's going. And the funny thing about being the antagonism, like I guess, person, is that there are times when rules have to be, they have to be pushed against.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I've been watching a lot of like these First Amendment auditors, you know?
Yeah.
And First Amendment auditors are interesting people, because when I first started watching this, I'm like, you're not being very agreeable. These are people that go into like public situations, whether it be a...
I think it's just to start a problem.
Yeah.
Is what you look.
That's what I thought. But these are people that go into like the post office, right? Public post office. These are people that go into like county buildings and government buildings, libraries. Yeah. And they'll simply film. Now, the thing is because it's not, you know, normal, which is kind of weird because everyone has a camera in their pocket, right?
Yeah.
People flip the F out.
Yeah.
And I've seen him, this guy individually, I've seen him be arrested and detained and all kinds of stuff doing a constitutionally like protected activity. And
yeah.
It's so funny how many people have no flipping clue what that means, because it's not normal. It's not agreeable. But the thing is if we don't exercise this, we'll lose it.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Well, yeah, because they call the police, the security, and they don't even know that it's a legal form of, like, they can come in there.
It's a Fourth Amendment, the freedom of press.
Yeah, they can come in there with a camera. They can come in there. There's certain areas they can't, and those guys never go in the areas you can't have the camera.
Yeah.
But just in a public space, you can.
And the interesting thing about this is that people get so up in arms, but it's like, you guys we throw this stuff away. But you look at this in the world of addiction recovery, and it's like, we've been told and pushed and pushed away and killed and overdosed for so long that, of course, no one's going to take us seriously. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And so there has to be a little bit of antagonism against that agreeableness, or else what's going to be the result?
Yeah. Everyone, just more control on the other side, right?
Absolutely.
You've got to be able to teach and have people understand.
Yeah, see, it works. All right, I'm going to turn that down for a sec. Now, the funny thing about this little TikTok deal that I thought was, this antagonism. Now, you guys can't see this, but I'm going to describe it to you before we play. It is a professor in a college, and there's a bunch of these students around.
Oh, yes, I saw this one.
And I was like, let me see what this, this white male, adult, what's he going to do here? But what he said was kind of amazing. So just picture any college, like class, right? And
professor.
That'll bring this into the...
Second desk, blue jacket. What is your name?
My name is Alexis.
Alexis, please leave my lecture room. I don't want to see you at one of my lectures ever again.
I don't understand.
I am not going to ask a second time. Thank you.
She gets up, she picks up her stuff, and all the students are kind of looking, and she just exits stage left. And all the students are watching her walk out.
Confused.
Why are there laws? What are laws for? Anyone?
Social order. Mm-hmm.
To protect the person's personal rights.
That's good.
So that you can rely on the government?
So you can rely on the government.
Interesting.
Justice? Thank you.
Justice.
Tell me, was I unfair to your classmate just now? Indeed I was.
No one said yes.
So,
though.
Why didn't any of you protest? Why didn't any of you try and stop me? Why didn't you want to prevent this injustice? You see, what you have just learnt, you wouldn't have understood in 1,000 hours of lectures unless you lived it. You didn't say anything because you weren't affected yourself. And this attitude speaks against you and against life. You think it doesn't concern you, so it's none of your business. Well, I'm here to say, if you don't help bring about justice, then one day you too may experience injustice, and there will be nobody there to stand before you. Truth and justice lives through us all, and we must fight for it. Because in life and work, we often live next to each other, but not with each other. We console ourselves that the problems of others are nothing to do with us, none of our business. And we go home glad at night that we're spared, but it's about standing up for each other. Every day an injustice happens in business, sport, or on the tram, relying on someone else to take care of it is not good enough. It is our duty to be there for others, to speak up for others when they cannot. I am here to teach you the power of your voice. I want you to learn critical thinking to empower you to stand up for what is right, even if it means going against what everyone else is doing.
Super easy to be inspired by that, but the practicality and the commitment of it is almost impossible. Because we live in a world right now where we're slipping in that degree of empathy, right? It doesn't concern me. That's a bad mindset. If we would have kept that mindset, we wouldn't have addict to athlete. We wouldn't have a lot of the different things that we kind of maybe take for granted, like with resources and whatnot. And it's because we decided to be an antagonist to the agreeable like norm. Does that make sense?
I remember there's been a few times now that our girls in high school, they've had some kind of walkout, right?
I remember I told Brooklyn.
And share that.
So, our kids, it's kind of funny. I'm not sure where they got their independence, but they are all very staunch in their belief systems, and it's kind of a funny thing. But several years ago, my oldest daughter, Brooklyn, it was one of those situations in junior high, where everyone's going to walk out, right? Mm-hmm. There was some kind of antagonist issue that was going on, and there was a feeling that something wasn't right. Mm-hmm. And she asked me as I was driving her to school, "Dad, at 10 o'clock, all the kids are going to get up and walk out of school. Would you be mad if I did that?" And I'm like, "Do you believe in what they're going to walk out for?" And she thought about it for a minute, and she kind of gave me that puzzled look. I said, "Look, if you're going to walk out at 10 a.m., mm-hmm. then you have to commit to me right now that at 10 a.m., you're not going to look around the room, you're not going to hesitate, that you believe in what this is about so deeply that even if you're the only one standing up and walking out and you're getting yelled at or sent to the principal's office or what have you, that you walk out because you truly believe in what this stands for.
You're willing to stand behind that belief." Yeah.
I said, "But if for a moment you hesitate and you look around, I do not want you walking out." And she's like, "Oh, I'll probably just stay put." Which is like, okay. But that was a thing, right? Is she was looking to me to like give her that okay, that if she was to walk out, she'd get in trouble. But the matter of the fact is, listeners, if you're going to break a rule, you've got to do it on purpose.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And I've seen
to
this.
Back it up.
I've seen this in a lot of different areas in life. And, you know, we can't be, you know, "Oh, I didn't know I was doing this or doing that." Like, that's dumb. That's just you trying to get out of whatever hot water you got yourself in. But if you truly believe in something, you've got to stand by it through thick and thin.
And the consequences of
And the
it.
Consequences. Because, again, as we get a little bit deeper into this, you know, the consequences of some of these people that are making fun of these poor folks that are caught in this, you know, this very bad situation, they're forgetting the fact that there are real people attached to this situation.
Mm-hmm.
And you trying to get some views and be funny and being an antagonist, that's not helping anybody. But being an antagonist for something that has purpose and could have changed, that's where we want to be.
Some social justice in certain things.
I've seen it in the state of Utah where we start seeing more and more people in the recovery world start to step up and demand their rights and demand their, you know, their adherence to things that they need in order to heal.
Our annual rally for recovery at the state capitol has gotten bigger and bigger every single year. And I believe because of that, Utah has been a lot more understanding, more empathetic to those who struggle with mental health and addictions, and have even filtered some of the federal funding coming to the state to those areas because people have stood up and said something.
Yeah.
And it's needed. Instead of just complaining about it, they're like, "Let me find who I need to talk to and what I can do to make a difference in this, because this is important to me."
Absolutely. So without this, without you standing up and saying, "No, that's wrong," or "This is what we want to do," then nothing changes. And that agreeable mindset kind of carries you through to a lot of different, like lackadaisical, like lifestyle situations. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
You know, so again, if you're going to break the law or you're going to break a rule, you got to do it on purpose. You know, you can't get pulled over because you're speeding on the highway and being like, "I didn't know." No, you were doing it on purpose. And unfortunately, you got caught, right?
Yeah, take responsibility.
But that's the thing even with addiction is if we were able to take accountability for our addictions, can you imagine what would happen instead of trying to blame shift it onto something else? Like most of us, and I'd say probably 90% of us, all have very good reasons to have had an addiction or to be struggling with addiction. We have histories of trauma and abuse and neglect and abandonment. We have all these pains that we've gone through, and those are great recipes to become an addict.
Yeah.
But when you realize and you recognize the fact that those are the core issues that created the addiction, then whose responsibility is it to go the opposite direction? And who is the only one that has enough power and authority in their own lives to change? Yourself.
Yourself.
So, you know, blame shifting is one thing. Being accountable is the other. But sometimes you have to be an antagonist to change. You know
and
what I'm saying?
Being able to do that with some education, with some self-awareness, and with some understanding of what you're doing it for, why, what's your backup, following through responsibility, that's one thing rather than just doing it for control or attention.
Yeah.
Right.
And so with this lack of empathy that I'm seeing in a lot of different kind of situations, where do you think that comes from? Where do you think this lack of empathy for people that are expressing some of the jokes or maybe the pointing the finger of this tragedy, even right down to your own personal lives where people won't listen or maybe they don't, you know, they don't care. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Where does that lack of empathy come from, you think?
Well, I think it's years and years worth of something. you know, it's, and obviously every person's different from just the way they were raised, the examples they have in their life. And then I think with a lot of technology and all of the information we have just at our fingertips and people being able to like put all of their opinions on social platforms, yeah, people want that control and attention. And then when that becomes abundant, then that's what people see. Like I've always said, we create our own algorithm for life. And so look at the things that you consume, and that's what you'll probably start creating yourself more of, because we create the algorithm. What we look at, watch, follow, like, buy is what we see when we go to social media. And so when people see that, they all of a sudden start doing more of it, whether they want to or not. That's just what they surround themselves with. And sadly, it's abundant everywhere. So
yeah,
it's what people see. And so then they duplicate it.
Absolutely. You know, it creates that low emotional intelligence, that burnout and that stress that kind of like dictates whether or not you're going to remain sober or if you're going to get back into your addiction, you know? And I really do think that this lack of empathy is going to cause a lot of problems in the future. And a lot of it is because we're not talking to human anymore. We're talking through computer screens and cell phones and things. Mm-hmm. And, you know,
that protection.
Yeah, there's a little bit, you can be a little bit more bold that way. And then not saying that that's wrong, but it's also like, can you recognize enough to take a step out and to understand where the person on the other side of that's coming from? You know, I don't know. I think a lack of empathy that we're going to start seeing here is going to cause a lot of social problems, you know.
I think it has.
And because it's not helping to us directly, like that professor said in that little video we just shared, you're going to be blind to it until it's too late. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Case in point, you know, why didn't every person in the United States of America stand up and say, hey, Sackler family, stick it up your you know where? The reason why they didn't get held accountable is because none of us really care. The majority of us don't care because we look at it as, well, those are drug addicts, when in actuality it wasn't.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
And now that it is affecting so many people on a personal level, all of a sudden they want to say something and do something. And now the problem's bigger than what we can really address simply. And, you know, but yeah, it takes a lot of work to practice pro-social behavior and being able to stand up for things that you believe in, to also just, yeah, not just always conform, but also look at things with a different telescope, I guess, or microscope.
Yeah.
You know, is this a good thing? Do I want to react? Yeah. Just that TikTok was perfect.
So you boil it down to this. It's like, well, then how do I know if I'm starting to be that get off my lawn guy, right? And I love the get off my lawn guy theory because I actually lived that. You know, we had a guy that lived on a corner of a house that I lived at as a kid for one of the 20 moves that we made. And it would literally save us all about 2 seconds to cut across his corner lot to get to the other side of the sidewalk to get home. And that 2 seconds must have been pretty important because we'd do it every day. Well, pretty soon he'd come out and start yelling, as one would, get off my lawn, right? So what would we do?
Go walk on the lawn.
Oh, we'd do even more, right? We made a game of it. We made a game of it to see how far we could get across before he yelled at us. We'd do it at night. We'd do it all the time. And too much so it started to wear a little path into his lawn and stuff. And, you know, we were getting very critical of him and, you know, for his comments towards us because we felt like, how dare you? It's his property.
Yeah.
It wasn't until I was a lot older when I realized the significance of behind what we were doing because one thing that I'd found out is that he took real meticulous care of his yard because that was something that he and his wife loved to do. And I didn't realize this at the time, but after he lost his wife, that was one thing he kept pride in because that was something that he felt close to her by out there doing it. So as we're walking on his lawn, kind of defiling, if you will, his property, it was like we were insulting his wife. And so we didn't know that at first. It took some maturity to figure that out. And then the guilt kind of kicks in. But when let's just say that we didn't have enough emotional currency to invest to understand the why.
Yeah.
That critical behavior that started as an adolescent can snowball into adulthood. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense? Maybe you have, you know, sharp parents, and they're the get off my lawn parents, right?
Yeah.
And then you have to get off my lawn neighbor. Then you have to get off my lawn cop. And then you have to get off my lawn judge. And you have to get off my lawn boss. You turn into this callous person who thinks truly that the world's against you.
Yeah.
Right? And then you start laying blame on people.
Yeah.
You start believing that, you know, you're too good to be suffering from this, so it must be everybody else.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, some victim stuff, and well, or even they owe me. Like, I deserve to, I hate that, I deserve, but I deserve to walk on his lawn. It's fine. It's no big deal. And who is he to tell me? And all of a sudden you start getting some of that antisocial behavior.
I see this right now in community specifically. I've watched a few documentaries and stuff on the troubles that San Francisco and California is experiencing, where they have an abundant issue with people stealing items and goods right out of stores. Yeah. Several years ago, the governor kind of lessened the degree of theft charges to have to reach a certain amount before it can become a crime. And lo and behold, everyone started stealing things and stores are closing down left and right. Like, there's no e-commerce, mm-hmm. there's no commerce anymore in downtown San Francisco. And people are wondering why. Well, because people are walking out with goods. This detachment of other people's emotions and needs. They look at my needs are more important than yours, so I'm taking this. I'm taking what I deserve.
Yeah.
And then people are getting upset because they're closing down shop, moving out. And guess what happens? All of a sudden, it takes you now what was, you know, 10 minutes to go get a gallon of milk is now going to take you 45 minutes or an hour. You're going to have to drive to get this stuff. You know, and it sucks. It's a hard thing, but when you start dismissing other people's emotions.
Yeah.
I was watching, I heard a little, you know, news clip on the way over on YouTube about a lady that chased down one of these thieves. Mm. He was on a motorized scooter. She was in a car. She cut him off. He wrecked and crashed and spilled all the goods that he stole. She gets out and she's chastising him. He's like, I'm going to call the cops. So the lady that chased him down to get her goods back is probably going to get more in trouble than the guy that stole the goods in the first place. So it's like, what is going on? We're dismissing people's emotions.
Yeah.
If you've ever had a mental health condition or an addiction, you've been a recipient of this. People have dismissed your emotional needs.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, and stigma and judgment.
Yeah, absolutely. And then, you know, what do? We kind of role reverse it, and we kind of make it look like that we're the ones that are in the right and everyone else is in the bad. And those relationships change ultimately to create a meltdown in your own life.
Yeah.
That is a scary outlook.
Yeah.
So why in the world do we need to work on our empathy? Why do we need to work on the skill set that will help open our hearts instead of closing it down? Because there's a lot of reasons to not let anything or anyone in.
Yeah, it's a lot of people like that protection. They think that's safe. But this world, our lives are about relationships. And if we cannot have relationships with others because we're too consumed in a selfish view, it's very difficult to build relationships outside of yourself. Mm-hmm. And so I think it has to be worked on. Like, it doesn't matter. Like, the world is made up of how many billions of people. We have to learn how to get along and work with other people. And I think the best way to do that is through increasing our empathy, you know, like work relationships, marriage, family relationships, let alone just regular relationships with people in the community that, you know, the grocery store or the garbage man or the mailman. Like, it's, yeah, long term, it can cause a lot of issues if we don't learn how to think outside of ourselves.
Yeah. Right? Well, tell me this then. Why is it, you know, and this is fresh in my mind because we just had him as a guest, but then why is it with, you know, individuals like Jason DeGraw, who, you know, the Addicts Fighting Back, come in here and tell me about how he can sit and talk to a homeless person, even if he has nothing to give him, and invest in that person just because he's a human, mm-hmm. where other people would look at that and be like, ooh, I don't know what I can do. I don't know what I can give. I don't know what I can say. I don't know what I should do. So I'm going to ignore them as if it's not
pretend they're not there.
So why is it that some people that would be labeled as addicts and lowlifes and downtrodden are the ones that typically are the ones that reach out and accept more?
Often it's because they've been there. I mean, Jason specifically talks about that and being homeless for a long time and feeling invisible. And he wants people to be able to see themselves, right?
Yeah, it's important. Again, the three human factors we need to be able to feel like we are who we are is to be seen, to be heard, and to be understood, right?
Yeah.
But if you're quick to anger and you're very unforgiving, you'll never have that. I remember there was this one time, this unforgiving thing, and this was, you know, I was quick to anger this. Years ago, a gentleman came into the place I was working at the county and said, hey, we want our company wants to give space to a program like yours. Would you want that? And I'm like, yeah, we'd love to have more space. And he had me come down and tour his facility. It was in East Bay, you know, Provo, Utah. And I went down there and I was touring it. It was a great facility. I'm like, this is awesome. Outdoor basketball courts and all kinds of stuff. I could totally do this. And he introduces me to this one man. I'll be nice and call him a man or a boy, I should say, a kid. And once he understood who we were, he's like, I don't want addicts walking around my building. And I was like, excuse me?
A little shocked.
And he's like, we have sensitive material in here and I don't want addicts walking around my building. And I was like, who in the F are you, right?
Yeah.
And I'm like, well, that's fine because we don't want to come here anyway. You know, and it, trust me, there was a little bit more emotion behind that. But I remember walking out with that guy who invited me and he's like, I am so sorry. I have no idea what that was about. I'm like, I do. I said, I'll bet you $1 million what this is about. Mm-hmm. That man has someone in his family that struggles with addiction so much so that he's probably been burnt. You know, he's probably been taken advantage of. He's probably had some rough experiences with.
Yeah.
But instead of seeing who we are and what we're doing, he's projecting that onto us as if
his
we
anger,
are one and the same.
His hurt, his frustration. Yeah.
So although I can't blame him, I'm going to blame him because I'm like, well, you just missed out on seeing some amazing change. Does that make sense? And I thought that is the dumbest thing ever. I could not believe it. I was so pissed. Do you remember that? It took me a long time to get over that because I was like, who, what in the name of my, because I'm just not used to that.
Yeah.
But I guarantee you that's what it is. So if you're in this unforgiving, kind of quick to anger, like mindset, you have zero empathy, you're going to be kind of alone and miserable, you know?
So what are some ways we can increase our empathy? Okay. One thing we can do is to just be curious, spend time with people you know don't know very well.
I like that.
Ask them about themselves. Ask about their life. Follow and get to know people from different backgrounds, different religions, different cultures. And, you know, it's got, be present with them when you're there talking. Don't worry about other things, but try to really be curious about other people. Visit new places, visit, you know, educate yourself about things. I think another one is being able to step out of your comfort zone. Talk to other people, try something new. And also being able to be humble, you know. And
you talk about Ted Lasso, be curious, not judgmental, right?
Oh,
let's be honest.
I love Ted Lasso. If you haven't seen it, let's talk about empathy, understanding social justice.
You want to see that? Watch Ted Lasso.
Ted Lasso. It's very much worth your time.
Mm-hmm.
Another one: be open to feedback. Be open to people maybe asking somebody else, "How can I improve? How can I be better? What are some opportunities maybe you need to open yourself up to try something new?" Then the next one's going to be like a reflective thing, like examine what your biases are. Find opportunities to like get to know people from other backgrounds and find out what it is that you have some biases about. In fact, we just re-released a podcast with Dr. Jared Hemmer, and I listened to it again. And I remember him talking about him having a lot of judgment and bias towards Muslims and homeless people. And so when he went to rehab, they sent him to go clean the bathrooms at a mosque and to go and serve meals at the homeless center. Mm. But identify where it is your judgments are and maybe get to know those people, the stories behind, and
that's
donate
a hard
to charities.
One. Right? That's a hard one because you may have to admit, dare we say, that you are wrong.
Yeah.
You know, that you are wrong. And I love that. You know, I remember early on in my career, you know, starting to hear this word MAT, and I was like, why? That doesn't make any sense. How do you fix an addiction by giving them like a substance? Mm-hmm. And, you know, a dear friend of mine, you know, guest on the program, you know, Bruce Chandler says, Blue, you've got to start researching and opening up your heart and mind to what's out there. He's like, it's a resource. And he was the one that kind of challenged me to say, you know, if you don't know it, don't just sit here and, you know, defend your stance, learn about it. And so I did. And guess what I learned?
There's a lot of research.
A lot of research and a lot of people I've worked with now that it works for.
Yeah.
And so when you hear some of these stauncher programs that are just like, oh, you can't do that, it's like, well, then you're falling behind and you're a nobody program anymore. So I get that. Research, you know, invest in it.
Yeah.
Find your bias.
Another one, walk in the shoes of others. Start understanding why, what it's like for other people in other situations. How is it that they live, they work, they, you know, and some of that is going to be spending time in uncomfortable situations, something new, something that you're not used to. Find out what their dreams are, you know, that's going to help increase that empathy. Another one, this is one you're good at, but have respectful conversations, like conflict resolution. And what is that?
Yeah. This is a hard one, too, because you have to kind of own your own in a situation. If you truly want conflict resolution, you have to be willing to listen and to, again, potentially be wrong. There's been many times where I've been very staunch in an opinion or an idea. And through that conversation, when you get out of the control talk and out of the reactively listening to what's going on, mm-hmm. and you get into that search and reflective listening type style, you can truly find a lot of movement in there. Conflict resolution is a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
Most people don't want conflict resolution. They want to be right.
Yeah.
And when you do that, you ruin all expectations to make things, you know, feel well. Both parties can always walk away and feel good about what's happened. But we live in a world now where, you know, if you lose
better
a conversation or debate or argument, then you're the loser. Mm-hmm. That's why you see some of those political people out there that call people names and do stupid things, is because they're trying to outspeak someone. And they're talking loud and saying nothing. They don't want conflict resolution. They want to be right, even when they know they're wrong. So one of the best things you can do is to seek understanding through communication.
Yeah. That means you're going to have to take a check in your ego.
Oh,
I think
big
that's one of the hardest ones, is when you listen, opening to new different ideas. Maybe you're going to hear something you don't want, that you don't like, that's going to just cut you right inside. And how do you smash that ego and just be there?
Yeah.
Just listen.
That's an absolute
And maybe
given.
Even having to needing to apologize.
Mm-hmm.
Like, oh boy, there we go. That's a rough
I like
one.
It.
How do you apologize? Research the issue, right?
Mm-hmm.
One of the other things you can do is join in a cause. I mean, get out there, do something to, it's kind of like I said earlier, to get involved, find a charity, find a nonprofit to help give back, get involved in community projects, get to know other people.
That happened with Addict to Athlete when we first started. Again, we came out of the blue in 2011. There wasn't anything else like this out there. And when the 12-step community got wind of something else rising up that was beginning to bring people in, they got turf guarding, right?
Mm-hmm.
They didn't know who we were. They didn't know what we stood for. They didn't know what we were about. And so they started making judgments. They started doing all those things, started, you know, arguing. We had a individual who I knew very well that was a very strong 12-step individual come in and publicly ridicule one of the athletes
In
one of our meetings. About how he was doing things wrong. And, you know, we kind of escorted him to exit stage left, as he did. And then once everyone started to catch wind of this, he caught some flack. He came back and said, you know what, I apologize. I need to do a little bit more research. He did. He invested into it. He learned about it. And him and his kids came out and ran one of our first 5Ks.
Yeah. Supported our group.
Yeah.
Supported it. And that's rough. You know, that's hard to be able to maybe say that you've done something wrong.
It was, too.
And I think one of the other things is really good, educate yourself, read, watch videos, get to know, like, newspapers, journal, you know, find information.
And don't and rely on one understand. Source. Well, there's this thing now. I don't know what you call it. You showed me a couple weeks ago, but it shows the left, the center, and the right.
It's called All Sides.
And I love it because you can see how one headline could be so misconstrued into like whatever paradigm you want.
Yeah.
I would say if you're so staunch in a political party, I definitely would say open up your horizons a little bit because both sides have some good stuff and both sides have some crappy stuff. But that center line, that's where I think intelligent like kind of lies. Does that make sense?
Yeah. And All Sides is great. You can follow them on social media and they'll post news and show what people are saying from the left, from the right, from the center. And
remember, you can find background and statistics and news to fit your bias.
Support you and everything.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So expand a little bit. You know, don't just take one word for it.
Yeah.
So
I like that.
When you look at this, listeners, the reason why I brought this up today as we kind of wrap this up, the reason why I brought this up today is because I truly felt as though there was some things happening out there that's starting to turn people's attention to the cold and the more bias. And that is not kind of, that's not going to be what's beneficial for you, for the people coming up behind you, for these opiate orphans we talk about a lot, for you know, anyone. And so be cautious about, you know, get off my lawn, so to speak.
Yeah.
Be curious, not judgmental, Ted Lasso. And really feel the magnitude of what happens because you show that degree of grace, what will come back to you tenfold will be the love and inviting and
understanding more people.
And relationships.
Yeah.
Right?
And that's got to be important, you know, as much as you think, obviously people have been hurt and they think other people hurt and so want to protect themselves, but life becomes more abundant with the more relationships we have.
That's why I love the Butterfly Circus. If you haven't seen the Butterfly Circus, you got to go YouTube and YouTube it. It's an amazing little
short film.
15-minute, you know, short film about this very thing. And the premise is, you know, it's a circus that comes through and kind of stops at a sideshow and they pick up this kid who's got no arms and no limbs. And the whole video premise is about him stepping out of his comfort zone and becoming more open to something else, a change. And I love it because there's this one line in there that just resonates with me. Well, there's several, but the one that I truly love the most pertains to a conversation that he's having. The first one being when he meets him and he gets up to him and he says to this guy who has no arms and no limbs, mm-hmm. and as they introduced him, they said, a man who got himself, you know, forsook. And he got real close to him. His name's Menendez. He got real close to him. He says, you're magnificent. And he spit on him.
Yeah.
He's like, oh, and the handler got upset and said, oh, you know, kind of pushed him away. But then the guy says, hey, no, I got too close. He owned it. He didn't judge him, but he's like, I got too close. Yeah. No big deal. But then the next one, when he was like kind of showing him that he was stronger than he thought he was, and he went into that situation with, you know, trying to push him to get out of his comfort zone.
Yeah.
And he said to him, he's like, well, who, what are you? The man who God himself first took. He said, why would you say that? And he says, because you believe it.
Yeah.
That's why on Team Addict Athlete, we don't call you addicts. And it rubs some people the wrong way, but I don't really care. On Team Addict Athlete, being an addict is a part of you. It's not who you are.
Something we believe in.
Absolutely. So if you are an addict and you believe that, that's all you'll ever be. But if you allow yourself to, you know, push that bias aside, you can introduce yourself into the authentic person you truly are. You know, you're a brother, a son, a daughter, a mother, an athlete, a scholar, an
employee,
artist, an employee.
Creator.
Yep. And yeah, you're an addict, but it's a part of you, not who you are. So you have to check your own biases in order to allow yourself to feel the empathy of who you are, what you stand for, and what you're going to give back to the world.
Absolutely.
So with that, I think we should probably wrap it up by saying jump onto the website, addicttoathlete.org. You'll find all kinds of resources there. You know, a lot of our backlog podcasts and a lot of our content that will help you kind of get in gear. If you want to create a program like Addict to Athlete in your community, jump on and check out our recovery coach training program.
Yeah.
It's a very intensive recovery coach program where you can either, you know, take the track to kind of create your own understandings, get more knowledge on the topic of addiction recovery, or you can use it to become a certified coach and open a chapter of Addict Athlete in your community. Firm believer that these grassroots level programs are what's really going to work for people long term, because they need someone like you who has a passion to help people, who wants to move them from addict to athlete and to create some cool experiences. You can check that out on our website. Anything else from your side of that table?
No. Get ready for our 5K September. Get registered. Again, you can do this anywhere. It's a virtual 5K as well as in Spanish Fork, Utah. Get family and friends together. We've had many people come, get matching shirts to, you know, commemorate either the celebration of somebody, a loved one in recovery, somebody who's still struggling, or somebody who's passed on.
Yeah, we'd love to have you here. Again, thank you so much for downloading, sharing, and subscribing to the podcast. Greatly appreciate you doing so. And until next time, continue to do your best to turn your mess into your message.